Well, hi everybody, and welcome back to our weekly Bible study here at King's Revival Church International. My name is Gareth, and I have the privilege to share this week's lesson with you. And I want to thank you for joining in today, wherever you are connecting from. It's awesome to have you with us today, and I know that this word is going to do something in your life. It's going to change your life. It's going to transform your thinking, and it's going to take your faith to a whole nother level. And that's what happens when we hear the word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So today we're hearing the word of God, and that's what we are for. It's a Bible study. We want to study God's word so that faith will rise up on the inside of us, and so that we can conquer the challenges that are in front of us, and that so we can overcome, and we can win. We can be successful. We can see the victory in our lives because of faith, because of Jesus Christ in us. He's the hope of glory. He is the light of the world. And so today, I'm just really grateful. I'm grateful that I can share the word of God with you. And I thank God for this ministry. I thank God for Pastor Deal, Mom Suhanti, and Diviner. I thank God that I'm part of this ministry. And what an honor it is to share the word of God with you today. So I thank Pastor Deal, my pastor, my spiritual father. I thank God for his life and the way God has used him and is continuing to use him throughout the world. So thank you, Pastor Deal. So today, the title of my message is Seven Laws for Uncommon Success. Seven Laws for Uncommon Success. And so I'm going to share seven laws that you must honor to have uncommon success, to see success within your life. You know, in Joshua chapter 1, God says that I will cause you to have good success. I will cause you to have the victory. If you meditate on me, if you put the laws in my law into your heart and into your mouth, and if you continue to do that and keep it before you, you will see good success. And so the definition, I looked up the definition of success, because success can mean different things for different people. And so the dictionary definition of success is the following. It's having a favorable outcome. It's having a favorable outcome. So we've got different situations, different things happening, and we're expecting different outcomes, right? Based on our specifics in our lives. And so it also says it's a favorable result. It's a positive result, and it is victory. It is victory. Success means victory. And I believe that God is not a God of defeat. He's not a God that wants you to fail. He's a God that has never failed, but he wants to bring victory in our lives. So the opposite of success is failure. All right. I believe that as born again Christians, God has called us to be victorious in every area of our lives. Success is not a season. Success is not a place, but success is an experience. You create success through your habits. You create success through the things that you do on a daily basis. And you can create success in a month. You can create successes in a week. You can create successes in a day. You create successes in a moment. And that can be habitual. It can be continuous, and it can be consecutive. And so I believe that the Father wants you to enjoy success within your life. But there's a problem, because in Isaiah chapter 4 verse 6 says that my people perish for a lack of knowledge. So every problem is always a wisdom problem. Therefore, ignorance is destroying people. Not a demon, not Satan, but ignorance. And so there's a difference between being stupid and being ignorant. Okay? There's a difference, right? Ignorance simply means that you don't know. You just don't know it. Right? That's ignorance. Stupidity is not caring to know. All right, that's a whole different thing. And so the question is, do you have a desire to know? Do you have a desire to get into the Word of God and a desire to learn? Do you have a desire for your faith to increase? Do you have a desire to be victorious within your life? Because I believe that's God's will. That's God's will for us. And so the gospel has two parts. The gospel has two parts. The person of Jesus and the principles of Jesus. One is the life of God within you, and the other is the law of God around you. One is the king, and the other is the kingdom. And so the person of Jesus creates your peace, and the principles of Jesus creates your prosperity. The person of Jesus prepares you for eternity, and the principles of Jesus prepare you for earth. And so there's people that know Jesus, they love Jesus, and they have Jesus within, and they're born again, but they are ignorant of the principles that operate in the kingdom that bring success. But I want to share some wisdom principles with you, some keys that you need to master, that you need to know in order to see success within your life. And so the Bible talks about wisdom is the principal thing. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 7, the Word of God says that wisdom is the principal thing. And so we need wisdom. We need wisdom. So what is wisdom? Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference. It is the ability to recognize difference. And so when Jesus was on the cross of Calvary and two thieves were on either side of him, only one of those thieves recognized the difference in him, in Jesus Christ. And in that moment, because he recognized who the man was, who Jesus Christ was, he repented and he was born again and he went into heaven, even in the last moments of his life. Remember the blind man who cried out to Jesus, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And so this blind man, he discerned that the presence of Jesus created a difference in that moment. So wisdom is the ability to recognize difference. Wisdom is also the ability to discern the difference in an opportunity. The ability to discern the difference in an opportunity. You see, the woman with the issue of blood for 12 years, she heard about Jesus. And she discerned that this was her opportunity to receive a miracle. She knew that if she would get around Jesus, that her life will change. And so she recognized that. And, you know, that day, Jesus didn't have any plans for her that day. But this woman had a plan, hallelujah, because she recognized an opportunity. And so the question that I want to ask you is, can you recognize an opportunity? Faith sees opportunity. Faith sees possibilities. Faith sees the potential. Faith sees things that are not as though they actually are. So when you operate from faith, you see the victory. When you operate from a standpoint of faith, you begin to believe God for the impossible. You begin to believe God for the supernatural. You begin to believe God for change. And so can you recognize an opportunity? And so when Jesus looked at the blind man, he actually asked him, he asked the blind man, what is it that you want from me? And so the blind man, he had to declare his need. You see, asking is the seed for receiving. Asking is the proof of humility. Asking is the evidence of faith. So today, I'm going to share with you some wisdom keys, seven laws, seven principles for uncommon success or uncommon victory within your life. And the first one, I've touched on it a little bit already, but law number one is the law of difference. The law of difference. The first law that you must honor is the law of difference. And so you need to learn to discern what is the difference in me and what is the difference in other people. Something within you that cannot be found in another person, because your difference creates rewards. Your difference creates rewards. What makes you different to everyone else? What do you, and some clues are to the what are the things that you love to do? What are the things that you love to learn about? That is the clue to your assignment on this earth. And so when I met my wife, I discerned that there was something different in her than the other woman that I was interested in or tried to pursue or right? And so when I looked at my wife, I discerned that there was a difference. Hallelujah. And then I made the right choice. Praise God. And so you must discover what your difference is. The greatest mind in the universe has designed you. God has placed a part of himself in you that nobody else possesses, but you've got to discover that thing. And so don't live the rest of your life without discerning the investment that God has placed into you, without discerning the gift that God has placed within you, because you are a carrier of his presence. You are a carrier of his uniqueness. And so the law of difference decides your importance. And so it's crucial that you discern what is it that makes me different, because there's value in that. And so your difference will always bring a reward. So law number one is the law of difference. Number two is the law of the mind. Is the law of the mind. Every life battle is a mind battle. If you win in your mind, you will win in life. If you lose in your mind, you're going to lose in life. Philippians chapter 2 verse 5 says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." So you need the mind of Christ. You've been given the mind of Christ, the Bible says. In Romans chapter 12 verse 2, it says, "And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." There needs to be a mind renewal. There's the law of the mind. You've got to have victory in the mind. And so there's three things that your mind needs. Number one, your mind needs a focus. Your mind is like a sponge. It takes everything in, but you've got to give it the right focus. You must focus on something in your future, because your memory replays the past and your imagination plays your future. And so God gives you pictures of tomorrow so that you don't have to go back to your past. In Isaiah 43 verse 19, I love this scripture. It says that God is going to do a new thing. He says, "I am going to do a new thing." And so what he does is, when you get born again, he gives you a new heart. He gives you a new life. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And so the God that we serve is a creator. And so what I've discovered is that successful people are extremely focused. They're focused on the goal. They're focused on where they want to go to. They're focused on what they want to accomplish. And so as Christians, why are we not focused? Why are we not focused on winning souls and making disciples? Why are we not focused on the kingdom assignment that God has placed upon us, right? So we've got to be focused on what God wants us to do. We've got to be honed in and laser focused and live a life according to God's plan and purposes for our lives. Or else we're just living a life without direction, without purpose, without meaning. So the law of the mind. So the first thing your mind needs is focus. The second thing that your mind needs is an instruction. Listen to Proverbs chapter 8, verse 33 to 35. "Hear instruction and be wise, and do not disdain it." Hear instruction and be wise. We need instruction. We need instruction from the Word of God. We need instruction from the Holy Spirit. "Blessed is the man who listens to me, watching daily at my gates, waiting at the posts of my doors. For whoever finds me finds life and obtains favor from the Lord. And so we see that the man who has instruction, the man who whose mind has instruction is blessed. They have favor from God. Proverbs 16:20 says, whoever gives heed to instruction prospers. Whoever gives heed to instruction prospers. And blessed is he who trusts in the Lord. So that talks about a man who's very focused. That talks about a man who's on an assignment. That talks about a man or a woman who's on a mission, who's received their marching orders from Jesus Christ, right? And so your mind needs an instruction. Once again, your mind's like a sponge, and there's so much of information coming at you at 100 miles per hour every day, all the time. So where are your instructions coming from? Number three, your mind needs a hero. You need a champion that will excite you. You need an example. Abraham was an example to Isaac and Jacob. Elijah unleashed passion in Elisha. Ruth loved the presence of Naomi. And Timothy was inspired by Paul. So you need, your mind needs a hero. Your hero decides your energy, your endurance, and your experiences. So the law of the mind, your mind is like a garden, right? And you are the gardener, and you have to pull out the weeds. You have to grow the flowers that you want the aroma of. And so guard your garden. Your mind needs focus, your mind needs instruction, and your mind needs a hero. So law number two is the law of the mind. Number three is the law of recognition. Anything you fail to recognize will exit your life. The Pharisees did not recognize that Jesus was the Christ. Elisha recognized Elijah's difference. You see, what I've discovered is that users, all they want is what is in your hand, but disciples want what is in your heart. Hallelujah. They want what is in your heart because they recognize that God's hand is upon them, that the anointing of God is there. And so disciples want to learn. They want to receive what is inside of you. Hallelujah. Because what is inside of you ultimately will bring that which is in your hand. But people, they just want the things. They just want to get from you. So be very careful. Users only want what's in your hand. And so the law of recognition. Listen to this story. A man, a true story, a man noticed he went to a flea market and he noticed it was $4 for a beautiful picture frame. But the picture wasn't anything special. It was nothing great. He actually didn't like the picture. He liked the picture frame. And so he bought it for $4. Then he went back home. And what he did was, he opened up the back to take the picture out because he wanted to replace the picture. And when he opened up the back, a piece of folded paper fell out of the back of the picture frame. And it was the size of a business envelope. And he looked at that and he didn't think much of it. It was like a written statement. And then his friend came by and his friend saw this piece of paper. And he implored him to go and get it researched because it was the Declaration of Independence of the United States, and it was an original. Hallelujah. This piece of paper sold for $7 million at an auction. A $4 frame, which was sold for $7 million, but he didn't know that. So what's my point? My point is, something you are not seeing is costing you. That's ignorance. And so humility is recognition of what you do not have. And so humility will cause you to search. Humility, the proof of humility is the willingness to ask questions. And so don't be afraid if you don't know. find out. If you don't know, ask. If you see someone that is operating on a level that is higher than you, then seek them out and learn from them. If you can't get to them physically, well, look at the books, read the books, look at what they're teaching. Go on the internet and learn from these people and catch what they have on the inside of them. So the law of recognition. Law number four. Law number four is the law of two. The law of two. It's interesting that Satan only showed up when Eve did. Satan never showed up until Eve showed up. That's interesting. Why? Because Eve was a threat to Satan. Why? Because one person cannot multiply. You need two. The law of two. Adam could not multiply until Eve entered his life. And so the law of two is about agreement, is about multiplication. You know, when God spoke the blessing over Adam and Eve, he spoke the blessing. He said, be fruitful and multiply. You see, multiplication is embedded in the blessing of God. Look at Matthew chapter 18, verse 19. The law of two is about agreement. Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. You see, when God wants to bless you, he brings a person into your life. Ruth was one conversation with Naomi away from her Boaz. David was one enemy away from his throne. You see, God uses people in your life. Be attentive to the law of two. Jesus sent them out two by two. In Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9 and 12, two are better than one. The threefold cord is not easily broken. When God gets ready for your future, he will send an intercessor. He will assign a mentor. He will assign an Elijah to your life. Praise God. So the law of two. Law number five is the law of place. Place matters. God made places before he made people. I'll say that again. God made places before he made people. When you receive a divine instruction, more often than not, you are sent to a specific place. Think about it. It happened in the life of Elijah. In 1 Kings 17:9, God says, arise and get thee to Zarephath, because there will be your next provision. It happened in the life of Jesus and the disciples. In Mark chapter 14, verse 15, he said, and he will show you a large upper room, furnished and prepared. There make ready for us. It happened when the Holy Spirit birthed the early church. In Acts chapter 1, verse 4, he says, make sure that you stay in Jerusalem. Go stay in the place that I've told you to stay. So the law of place, the law of place. That was the secret to the general of the Syrian army, Naaman. That was the secret to his healing. He said, the prophet said to Naaman, go to the Jordan River. That is where you are going to get your miracle. And then he was healed of leprosy. It was the command to the blind man. He said to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam. He gave him specific instructions. You see, your provision is at a place. Hallelujah. Remember in John chapter 21, in verse 3 and 6, the disciples had been fishing and they'd caught nothing. But then Jesus spoke to them and said, no, don't throw your nets there. Throw your nets over there. Throw your nets on the other side. And so what we can learn from this is that finances, supernatural provision is waiting for you at the place of obedience. Come on. God instructed Abraham, leave this place, because God arranged his future away from his comfort zone. And a lot of people are not willing to leave their comfort zone to go where God has called them to be, to go to a place, to move when God says move, to change when God says change. And so the law of place, Jesus recognized that he was not welcome in all places. He wasn't welcome in certain places. And so the Bible says he left Nazareth and he went to Capernaum. So go where you are celebrated, not where you are tolerated, because you belong somewhere. You don't belong everywhere. Hallelujah. In Matthew chapter 10 and verse 11 to 14, it says, "Now, whatever city or town you enter, inquire who in it is worthy, and stay there till you go out. And when you go into a household, greet it. If the household is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. And whoever will not receive you, nor hear your words, when you depart from that house or city, shake off the dust from your feet." So the law of place, you will succeed somewhere. Have you found your place? Somewhere your territory has your name on it. Your assignment is not everywhere. Your assignment is somewhere. And you know what? The Apostle Paul, he understood this, that he wasn't an apostle to all people. He had a sphere of influence, which included the Corinthian believers. Look at what Paul says in the second book of Corinthians, chapter 10 and verse 13. "We, however, will not boast beyond proper limits, but will confine our boasting to the sphere of service God himself has assigned to us, a sphere that also includes you." So that word sphere of service is called metron in Greek. It's called a measure. Some translation says the measure that God has given you. And so metron means a determined extent, a portion measured off or limit, or in other words, a sphere of authority and anointing and influence. And when you learn to know your place, you will operate in a greater flow. You will operate in the most grace and the most favor and the most power. Hallelujah. So the law of place. Number six is the law of honor. And this one is huge. Every sin on earth is a sin of dishonor. You know, if you think about the Ten Commandments, the first four deal with honoring God. The last six deal with honoring people. So honor is different from wisdom. Wisdom is the recognition of difference. Honor is the willingness to reward somebody for their difference. And so honor is the seed for access into any environment on earth. Honor decides who desires you, who accepts you and rewards you. And so honor will take you further than your genius. It'll take you further than all your experiences in your life. And when you look at Jesus, he judged others by their willingness to show honor. For example, remember Mary. Mary took that expensive spikenard and she broke that and she washed the feet of Jesus. So who have you chosen to honor through your words, honor through your time, and honor through your friendships? And who have you chosen to dishonor or to ignore or to trivialize? Whose voice have you chosen to trust? And when it comes to the workplace, diligence is in the workplace is proof of honor. Diligence is immediate attention to an instruction. Delayed obedience is the proof of dishonor. So when people show you what they really like, believe them. When they show you their true colors, you got to, that's who they are. And so honor is the bridge to any season you would like to enter. Honor is the seed for access. Those who honor you qualify for a different relationship with you. The people that honor you, they qualify for a gracious relationship. They qualify for a growing relationship. The people that honor you, they qualify for a long-term relationship. And so learn to celebrate the difference of those who carry the aroma of honor. It's huge. Never reward people according to their need. There are always people with needs. You need to respond to the people proportionate to their honor. Praise God. Remember, I said earlier on, users, parasites, want what is in your hand, but disciples want what's in your heart. I've had people that come to me, they come to me for money, come to me for this and that, and I've given many times before. And then there are some that they come out of nowhere, ask me for something, and then I never see them again after that. they didn't want, they just wanted what I had, right? And so then I got to a point where, you know what, I've got to begin to discern because I've only got so much, right? And you can only give so much of your time. You can only give so much of your resources. And then you've got to begin to discern, well, who do I give to now? Because I can't give to everyone. The Bible, even Jesus says, the poor you'll have with you always, right? So you decide and you choose. And so one of the indications as to who you need to reward is the one that shows you honor. Why would you give to people that don't show respect and don't show honor? That's why the Bible talks about throwing your pearls to the pigs. When you get older, you realize that time is short. You realize that your time is precious, that the most valuable commodity on this earth is your time. And so you don't want to give your time to people that don't value you, that don't want what's in your heart and not what's in your hand. So reevaluate every relationship in your life by the law of honor. Dishonor qualifies. Dishonor destroys. Dishonor exposes a deceiver. So how do you recognize a person of dishonor? Well, remember the prodigal son? The son sneered at the lifetime teaching and provision of his father. The prodigal son even had the audacity to ask his father for an inheritance that he didn't earn. The first clue to dishonor is the request for something unearned. What you refuse to learn from people, you will learn through pain. Dishonor is a choice. Restoration rarely occurs after a decision of dishonor has been made. So be careful who you dishonor. The Bible teaches to honor your parents. Many times, things go wrong in people's lives, believers' lives. Many times, things, you know, they're struggling. Born again, struggling, but they've dishonored their parents because of a mistake that their parents have done. Because of whatever, one, two, three, whatever. And they haven't forgiven, and they don't honor their parents. The Bible says it'll go well with you. It'll be well. You'll be blessed when you honor your parents. And so that's a law. The law of honor. Honor can be taught. You know, marriages fail not because of unfaithfulness. Marriages fail because of a lack of honor. Unfaithfulness occurred because there was a lack of honor. And so honor is a seed. Honor is a law. Honor is a decision. And so you need to identify disrespect and change any part of your life where there has been dishonor. The last one, law number 7, is the law of the seed. A seed is a beginning. And the Bible is a book about the law of the seed. Words are the seeds for feelings. Mercy is the seed for change. Honor is the seed for access. And gratitude is the seed for increase. Whatever you are thankful for will increase. Seeds, the law of the seed. Jesus was a seed. God had a son, but he wanted a family. So he planted his son on the cross of Calvary to create his family. Hallelujah. And I love Mark chapter 10, verse 28. Jesus teaches us that anything you give up for him, he will return 100-fold. It's talking about seed and harvest time. And so the Lord of the seed means that something you have been given will create anything else you have been promised. What has God told you to sow? What seed remains unplanted? Something in your hand controls your future. Hallelujah. Today we are talking about success. We are talking about victory. Do you want to see victory in your finances? Well, then it starts with a seed. Hallelujah. And I want to end off with this scripture. The Lord spoke to me about this. I've been meditating on this scripture for a while. It's found in Zechariah chapter 8 and verse 12. Very powerful scripture. It says the following: for the seed shall be prosperous. The vine shall give its fruit. The ground shall give her increase. And the heavens shall give their due. I will cause the remnant of this people to possess all of these. You see, the spirit of poverty is broken by a seed. the spirit of poverty and lack and insufficiency is broken by a seed. And so the Bible says that the seed shall be prosperous. There is always a harvest in a seed. It says the vine shall give its fruit. You see, that speaks of a harvest. When you sow, there will be fruit. A harvest always starts with a seed. And look what happens when you plant the seed. It says that the ground shall give her increase. So when you plant the seed into the soil, it says that the ground will give its increase. But when you plant in the natural, the heavens begin to open. Because it says, and the heavens shall give their due. I'll read that again. The ground shall give her increase, and the heavens shall give their due. When you sow in the natural activates the supernatural, where the heavens begin to open up, and where the blessing begins to flow. And so the ground is the natural, the heavens is the supernatural. Sow your seed in the ground and watch the heavens open up over your life. For the seed shall be prosperous. And so I want to encourage you, go over these laws, write these laws down, get these scriptures, meditate on it. And I believe that God is going to bring you good success. He is our success. Jesus is our success. And we need to know the principles of Jesus. My people perish for a lack of ignorance. We don't want to be an ignorant people. The people that don't know their Bible are ignorant. The people that don't know the Word are ignorant. And that causes their destruction. But today we are not an ignorant people because we are a knowledgeable people. We are faithful people because faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. We get our wisdom from this book. We get our life from this book. This is our source. This is our energy. This is our lifeline. This is the air that we breathe. The wisdom. The word is his wisdom. Hallelujah. And I want to encourage you today. I want to pray over you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for everyone listening today. I thank you, Father, for breakthrough in their lives. I thank you for healing, Lord. I pray for healing over them. I pray, Lord, that they will see the miracle in this time. Jesus said, whatever you've given up for my sake, I will return 100-fold. I pray for 100-fold return, Lord. We speak breakthrough. We speak victory. Victory in your health. Victory in your finances. Victory in your marriage. Victory in your family. Victory in your workplace. Victory within you, Lord. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. Well, God bless you, church. Thank you for joining me today. I'm so excited and I'm looking forward to seeing you at the services, and I'll see you next week. Bye-bye for now.